House in Soho, won an Oscar for his work in the film Gladiator in 2001, and the other big show we work on is Doctor Who. They first mentioned doing a talking dragon, and we said, yeah, we bit their arm off when they said that, because if you're working this business, that's the kind of thing you really want to be doing. It's an extremely difficult challenge to make a dragon talk, because while we've done other talking characters with the bespoke facial tracking system that we've invented over the last few years, they'd normally been sort of humanoid figures, and you can make a chimpanzee talk because you can track the facial expressions of an actor onto a chimpanzee or a monkey, for example, because it looks vaguely humanoid. But a dragon, which has kind of a maw, is quite a hard one to make talk. John Hurt has one of the best voices in the acting profession today. It really helps us to have a slight exaggeration of the facial performance, because it translates really well onto, you know, the model of the dragon. Well, his performances are always amazing in whatever he's in. So, you know, the dragon is another John Hurt performance. Throughout the series of Merlin, there is a cast of mythological creatures that Arthur and Merlin have to face or that pose a threat to Camelot. There are spiders, there's a griffin that attacks Camelot and villagers outside. We have a cockatrice, we have a questing beast, we have CG snakes in the second episode that come to life out of a shield. So there's a lot for people who work in our business to play with, and it's a lot of fun. And I think you obviously need a degree in mythological creatures to get to grips with some of it.
Tell me, Merlin, do you know how to walk on your knees?
No.
Would you like me to help you?
I wouldn't if I were you.
Why? What are you going to do to me?
You have no idea.
Be my guest. Come on. Come on. Come on. I'm going to throw him in jail for that.
Well, who do you think you are, the king?
No, I'm his son, Arthur.
Medieval hero and heir to the throne, Arthur is the hard-fighting, rough-and-tumble action prince of Merlin's Camelot. Bradley James reveals how the crown fits.
The big appeal of the role is being able to sort of be a big kid, which is a lot of fun. I find myself quite often swinging a sword around or riding a horse or climbing a wall or doing something that's fun. And the environment's pretty good. We've got a, you know, sort of fun set of characters within the cast. Yeah, it's an enjoyable work experience.
From henceforth, you shall be crowned Prince of Camelot.
I like to describe him as incredibly misunderstood, largely due to the fact that he has a huge responsibility, and there's a lot of pressure put on him by his father, and the result of that is that he has this sort of arrogant front that he puts on.
After Sophia left, I wanted to take my mind off her, so I went for a hunt.
And killing things mends a broken heart?
No, but it's good fun.
I sort of always say that Arthur's kind of the medieval sportsman in that respect. It sort of is something that I relate to. You know, I've been very fortunate to be able to do the show. It's, as I say, it's a lot of fun. It's, you know, you sort of, not all jobs kind of have the perks of this one. Like, the environment to work in that the producers have created is kind of terrific. And from what I don't have vast amounts of experience on this, but from what I've heard of other shows, it's not always the case with other productions. So, yes, I'm quite pleased with that one. When the show started, we didn't sort of target Australia as the place that was going to, you know, was going to do particularly well, but apparently it has, and I got information on that firsthand by a girl who managed to ring around all the hotels in the area that we were staying in France and asking for Bradley James, and eventually she got through to the right hotel. So, hello, how you doing? She sort of told me the show was doing really well, and she seemed really excited about it, so I'm very pleased that it's taken off.
Still to come on Merlin, the secrets behind the magic.
This is funny, I'll show this. This is our prop master. He was desperate to get himself into the show.
This is the council chamber / cave. And this is
the man from the painting.
This is obviously my true love, Morgana's true love, because his picture is in my chambers. And I would like to point out that I'm very jealous that he gets a crown, I don't.
It's tiara.
Oh, sorry, it's tiara.
In series two, which
we're working on. And Merlin says too much.
There is a bit of a love interest coming up for Merlin.
Angel Colby and I play Gwen.
And I'm Kate McGrath and I play Morgana.
And we're going to show you around the set of Merlin. We begin here in Gaius's chambers,
which is quite an exciting place. There's lots of things to sort of look at and lots of details and some quite strange things.
Like, you wonder what the sort of set decorators have decided about our characters by the things that they put in our rooms. So there's a pufferfish, a mini crocodile.
And that thing is really, really scary.
The rabbit mask, which scares everyone.
It's kind of Donnie Darko-esque. And that's Merlin's bedroom up there.
He doesn't get anything.
He often walks up there and slams the door.
If I can't use magic, I might as well die.
Do you head over here? This is my house, or Gwen's house. And anyone who's seen Series 1 may notice that my house is quite a lot bigger than it was last time. Had a bit of an extension put on. Had a bit of an accident doing some cooking at one point. I don't think Gwen's a very good cook, but, you know, when she's queen, she won't need to worry about cooking.
What's in it?
It's smoked pigeon, but I'd say there's more smoke than pigeon.
Oh, here, look, here we go. This out here. You look out here.
Oh, yeah.
They made a painting. Well, let's not open that. Usually works. I don't know if you can see it, but the set have painted a sort of a double of the castle in France so that when we're shooting, they can sort of see, we can see this in the background. You can sort of fuzzily think that it's the castle.
Thanks.
This is funny. I'll show this. This is our prop master. He was desperate to get himself into the show.
This is the council chamber / cave.
And this is
the man from the painting.
This is obviously my true love, Morgana's true love, because his picture is in my chambers. And I would like to point out that I'm very jealous that he gets a crown and I don't.
It's a tiara.
Oh, sorry. It's a tiara.
Merlin's adventures are by no means over. For him and the characters of the world of his adventures, the best is yet to come. Season 2 is just around the corner.
With Season 2, it's going to be bigger and bolder and with much more excitement.
All the seeds that have been sort of sown in Season 1 start to grow in Season 2. So if you have any questions, if you have any sort of lingering doubts about, you know, any of the characters at the end of the season, I think they will start to be answered next year, so I think you should stay tuned.
We're very bound to it's printed on every script we get. The contents of this script are entirely confidential, so fortunately we can't reveal too much, but I can guarantee you won't be disappointed.
I am in anticipation, as everyone else, as to how it's going to turn out for Season 2.
Probably more scared of you than you are of it.
End of the show. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you so much for supporting the show and loving it as much as you do. It means a lot.
Yeah, it really does.
But next up is episode 10, which is quite exciting.
We're amazing in it.
There's a big battle. And both Katie and I have swords.
Yeah. And we know how to use them.
Definitely a reason to watch.
To no other.
Indeed.
Yeah. Again, best thing in it.
Yeah,
totally.
But you have to go now, I'm afraid. So go and watch episode 10 and enjoy.
Thank you.